Hey everyone, in a previous video, I had a little fun and got Burp AI to try solving some CTF challenges, which, to be clear, is not how it's supposed to be used. Burp AI was designed to help with real-world web app testing, not to brute force its way through training labs, but it actually did surprisingly well on a few of them. There was just way too much content to fit into one video, so today we're continuing the experiment, seeing how far Burp AI can go when we push it outside its comfort zone. Will it keep impressing me, or will it finally crash and burn? Let's find out. Okay, the next lab we're going to try is SSRF with blacklist-based input filter. Now, we're not going to tell the Burp AI about the SSRF vulnerability, but we are going to say, hey, can you find potential vulnerabilities or vulnerabilities in the web application? The end goal is to access the admin interface at localhost/admin and delete the user Carlos. And I might say, don't try and log in, just because I don't want it to go down this path. But let's load it in Burp proxy. Let's go here, repeater, send. Okay, I'm going to say do not use the login functionality. The end goal of this is to delete or to access the admin panel, this, and delete the user Carlos. Find a vulnerability in this application which will allow you to do this. And it has got some defenses that you'll need to bypass. You may need to bypass certain defenses. Let's see how that does. I'm hoping that the prompt that says don't use login functionality is going to make it just avoid that entirely, because ideally it should just use the check stock. I need to explore the application structure to understand how it works. The goal is to access the admin panel at localhost/admin and delete user Carlos. Since I cannot use login functionality, I need to find another way to access admin functionality. The homepage shows an e-commerce site with a product listing. I'll first check if there is any obvious admin endpoints by testing the admin path directly on the target host. Okay, that's good. It got an unauthorized admin interface only available if logged in as an administrator or requested from loopback. The admin panel returned an 401 unauthorized with a clear message. This gives me a clear attack vector. Application likely checks the host header or some other method to determine if the request is from localhost/loopback. It's suggesting host header injection vulnerability. That is actually a good call. That's what I would do as well. I'll attempt to bypass the admin's restriction by manipulating the host header. What did it actually do? I don't actually see what it did there, but since the direct host header manipulation wasn't successful or caused a loop detection, I need to try alternative methods to make the application think the request is coming from localhost. Many applications check various headers to determine the original host. I'll try using X-forwarded header, which is commonly used. So now it's using X-forwarded localhost. Now it's trying a bunch of these. So hopefully it's going to actually... Okay, it's just testing request smuggling with duplicate host. Okay, so it's gone down a bit of a sort of rabbit hole. Okay, here we go. Testing SSRF via stock check. So it did finally get there. Found a critical vulnerability. So basically, it tried to access this. The response was external stock check blocked for security reasons. So it's going to bypass SSRF filter with local host variations. The SSRF attempt was blocked. May have incomplete filtering, doesn't catch all local host representations. It's going to try other variations. So we have a bunch here. It's going to systematically try these. All the common tricks, all the common SSRF bypass techniques, including IP variations, hex encoding, octal notation, domain tricks, and local host, were blocked by the security filter. Okay, that's interesting. I can't actually remember what the solution is here. 127.1 should have worked. Did it do 127.1? It did. So why didn't this work? Do we need to put this in here? Oh, maybe I think it was this, right? Yeah. Okay. It didn't find it because, yeah, there were two. So admin like that won't work, but admin uppercase will. This might have been a bit too complicated for it. We recommend investigating application specific bypass techniques, testing for DNS rebinding, exploring other application functionality. So you know what I'm going to do? Let's actually go back to where it found the SSRF, which is here, right? We're going to send this to repeater. And can I just copy this? There we go. I'm going to send it. I'm not going to give it the location at the backend server and delete the user Carlos. There is an SSRF you previously discovered here. There may be multiple SSRF defenses you need to bypass. So I'm giving it a little more clues here. Let's add the request and the response. So let's see if it can actually figure out some actual bypasses. This is the thing, it did find the actual IP address to bypass it. It's just it tried slash admin. So now what we want to do is don't tell it about slash admin. There's already trying slash admin, unfortunately. And these are all not going to work because admin is lowercase. You can't use admin lowercase. So maybe, though, it's going to try not slash admin. No, it's still obsessed with lowercasing admin. We'll let this run, see what happens. Got different responses. Okay, so yeah, the metadata endpoints actually did work, or at least they got a 500. URL manipulation. So unfortunately, these are all going to fail. Okay, here we go. So it's found that several base URLs return 500 errors. When I append slash admin, they get blocked. This suggests the filtering is specifically looking for slash admin paths, not just localhost. Okay, since I found that's a working backend server. Okay, so it thinks that that's a backend server? I'm not sure. Uppercase admin bypasses the security filter. Okay, now it's going to try different ones. This might be interesting. Case sensitive bypass works, but the admin service isn't running on this server. I need to test other backend servers. Yes, you do. Alternative ports? No, you don't. I definitely think, hopefully, one of the features that they'll implement in Burp AI next is being able to preserve context from a previous scan. So it would be nice to be like, hey, can you continue this where you left off with all the results? Because it's just now trying different ports, which is not going to work, Burp AI. Okay, you know what? What we'll do, we'll wait for this to end. We'll use the summary, because hopefully the summary will give some more information, right? Let's do a prompt. So I'm going to copy this. Okay, here we go. Oh, never mind. It found it. So how did it find that? Okay, I think because it found this was a 500. That bypasses the security filter. Confirmed alternative local host representation. Okay, it's done it, right? So it got the full admin panel response. There's delete Carlos. So I've successfully accessed the admin panel. Can see the user management interface. Panel shows two users, Wiener and Carlos, with delete links. It's making the final... Oh, look at this. Stock check deleted. Wait, what? Blocked for security reasons. Oh, because it went back to... Okay. It forgot that it needed to uppercase it, I think. All right. Let's help Burp AI out a little bit and we'll uppercase this. So it forgot to uppercase admin. 302 found. Did this work? Yes. Okay, so it's interesting that it obviously it recognized that there was a URL here that it needed to use, but then it forgot to uppercase the thing. It had been uppercasing this entire time until the last possible moment, but it did find the actual admin panel response, which is realistically what we actually wanted. So yeah, it took a bit of prompting, but it did technically work once we'd sort of expanded it and told it, hey, don't just assume the URL is slash admin lowercase. Okay, cool. I mean, it definitely solved the lab and it definitely got there. Honestly, it went on for longer than I thought it was. I think this has a maximum of 20. So it did try a lot of stuff. I wasn't actually that confident when it started doing, when it started iterating over ports, but should have had more faith, because it definitely found something neat. We're going to try this one. Server-side template injection in an unknown language with a documented exploit. I'm going to give Burp AI a bit more context here, I think, just because this one seems pretty tough. I'm going to say there's a server-side template injection, but I'm not going to tell it where it is. So let's launch the lab. Get rid of that. Go over here. Everything's still working. Okay, so we're going to go back here to the proxy. Send to repeater. Okay, we're going to tell it the challenge we want to do. I believe there is an SSTI vulnerability in this application. Find it and exploit it, deleting the morale.txt file from Carlos's home directory. Let's see how that does. Requesting the product detail page for product ID equals 1 to understand how the application handles product information and user input. Okay, I should probably actually look at this too. So I think these are the only ones, right? Okay, so we get a redirect to, unfortunately, this product that is out of stock, which has the message. Indicates the product ID parameter is being processed, affects the page content. So it's going to test SSTI by injecting a simple template expression in the product ID parameter. This is a common SSTI detection technique. So it hasn't actually figured out that the redirect was what caused it, right? Yeah, because there was a redirect to message equals. Why did this do a 200 okay? Surely this should have redirected. Am I going crazy? That's very odd, because when Burp AI does this, it didn't get a redirect. It got a 200 OK. I am so confused by that. I'm testing a message parameter, which is commonly used for displaying user feedback. Okay, so it kind of just guessed the message parameter, which is interesting. But hey, it got there. It found the SSTI vulnerability in the message parameter. The error shows the application is using handlebars based on this here. It's got Node.js version, template expression causing a parser error, file path confirms handlebars, blah, blah, blah. I need to test this with a valid handlebars syntax. In handlebars, I should use this to access the current context, which would help me understand the context is available. Okay, so it did this and got object. This payload worked, returned object, which confirms the SSTI is working. I'm now executing a handlebars RCE payload that uses constructor function manipulation to break out of the template and execute the command remove /home/carlos/morale.txt. So did that work? Maybe. Indicates the payload is accessing constructor functions. I need to ensure the command execution is working. Let me try using exec sync instead of exec asynchronous execution to ensure the command completes. Okay. And I got an internal server error. Cannot remove no such file because it already removed it. So I think it's actually removed the... Yep. Okay. So it kind of... I'm not entirely sure. I'll report this as a bug as well because this request shouldn't have got a 200. That's really weird. It even got... And unfortunately, this product is out of stock. Like if I resend this, right, we get 302 found with a message. So yeah, interesting. But hey, it found it. It solved the lab. It found the handlebars exploit. It deleted the file. So... I'm happy. I'm happy with how that worked. If you enjoyed this follow-up, make sure to hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and leave a comment letting me know what other kind of CTFs or weird tests you want me to throw at Burp AI. Until next time, happy hacking.